meantime, President Trump and House Speaker Nancy Pelosi are again debating about that funding or lack thereof for a border wall. They haven't met face to face since January 9th, but the fighting is nonstop. Here's what the president told CBS's Face the Nation.
Well, I think that she was very rigid, which I would expect, but I think she is very bad for our country. She knows that you need a barrier. She knows that we need border security. She wanted to win a political point. I happen to think it's very bad politics because basically she wants open borders. She doesn't mind human trafficking, or she wouldn't do this because, you know,
she
the traffickers.
She offered you over $1 billion for border security.
Excuse me?
She offered over $1 billion for border security. She doesn't want the wall.
She's costing the country hundreds of billions of dollars because what's happening is when you have a porous border and when you have drugs pouring in, and when you have people dying all over the country because of people like Nancy Pelosi, who don't want to give proper border security for political reasons, she's doing a terrible disservice to our country.
The president has threatened to declare a national emergency if Congress does not give him the $5.7 billion to build a border wall. And he's teasing, more like threatening, the possibility of making a decision during his State of the Union address next Tuesday. CNN White House correspondent Boris Sanchez is in West Palm Beach, Florida, where the president is spending the weekend golfing. Boris, what's the reaction to what the president has to say, particularly about, you know, Nancy Pelosi?
Hey, Fred. Yeah, Democrats are firing back at the president, suggesting that he is mischaracterizing their position on border, that Democrats want open borders, and that Nancy Pelosi is bad for the country. A spokesperson for the House Speaker, Drew Hamill, put out a statement to CNN, shooting back at the president, writing, quote, President Trump's recklessness did not make us safer. It undermined our security with 35 days of Border Patrol agents, DEA agents, FBI agents, and Homeland Security personnel missing paychecks. Democrats have put forward strong, smart, and effective border security in the bipartisan conference committee, while the president still refuses to take shutdown off the table. The president's wild and predictable misrepresentations about Democrats' commitment to border security do nothing to make our country safer. We should point out Democrats have made some concessions to Republicans to a border security, offering up money for enhanced technology at the border. However, in negotiations, they have not included a single cent for the president's long-promised border wall. And of course, as you heard there, committed to getting that wall. He says that any kind of border security is impossible without one. Mm-hmm. That's why we're hearing frustration from the president and his threat to declare a national emergency. No national emergency today, though. Take a look at this tweet the president put out. He's golfing today with Tiger Woods and Jack Nicklaus. This is the president's first trip to Florida of 2019, Fred.
All right. And there's a tweet right there. Boris Sanchez, thank you so much. We apologize. It's not your television set at home. Yes, there were some president's plan for a border wall. And she had choice words for the president's attacks on Speaker Pelosi.
First of all, let me say that the words were shameful and inappropriate for a commander in chief. The Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, is third in line to the presidency. I wish the president would read his constitution. And she has every right to lead the Congress, to lead the House on views that she has. What we are saying is we want to be appropriate, thoughtful, and listen to the experts dealing with this question. The president wants a fight. He only wants to be political. He doesn't have any guardrail of leadership that allow him to sit down and understand to do the best plan.
But he has
Let me tell you what the president has
times.
Created.
He Pardon has me? Changed his jargon in that he'll say, okay, if not a wall, then a fence, a barrier, et cetera, kind of all encompassing. Does that make a difference?
But he has said all of those things. He's thrown them all up against the wall. And then he comes right back again and says, forget about it. I'm going to do an emergency order, which has certain criteria, which includes a national emergency. You're using the military, and it indicates that the country is in jeopardy, which we are not.
Congresswoman Sheila Jackson Lee. So lawmakers have until February 15th to come up with a deal to to avoid another partial government shutdown. All right, coming up next, all eyes on Virginia as Democratic Governor Ralph Northam prepares to address a racist photo found in his medical school yearbook. He's expected to speak at any moment. We'll bring that to you live as it happens. Stay with us. All right, in walking Virginia Democratic Governor Ralph Northam to make his statement. Let's listen in from Richmond.
Good afternoon. Thank you all for being here. I'm pleased to be joined by my wife, Pam. Pam, thank you for being here as well. There has been much public discussion about racist and offensive materials that appear on my page of the 1984 Eastern Virginia Medical School yearbook. And I believe it is important for Virginians to hear directly from me and for me to answer as many questions as are necessary about these circumstances. With that in mind, I would like to read a statement about these events, and then I will be glad to take your questions. Yesterday, I took responsibility for content that appeared on my page in the Eastern Virginia Medical School yearbook that was clearly racist and offensive. I am not and will not excuse the content of the photo. It was offensive, racist, and despicable. When my staff showed me the photo in question yesterday, I was seeing it. I did not purchase the EVMS yearbook, and I was unaware of what was on my page. When I was confronted with the images yesterday, I was appalled that they appeared on my page, but I believe, and now, that I am not either of the people in that photo. I stand by my statement of apology to the many Virginians who were hurt by seeing this content on a yearbook page that belongs to me. It is disgusting. It is offensive. It is racist. And it was my responsibility to recognize and prevent it from being published in the first place. I recognize that many people will find this difficult to believe. The photo appears with others I submitted on a page with my name on it. Even in my own statement yesterday, I conceded that, based on the evidence presented to me at the time, the most likely explanation that it was indeed me in the photo. In the hours since I made my statement yesterday, I reflected with my family and classmates from the time and affirmed my conclusion that I am not the person in that photo. While I did not appear in this photo, I am not surprised by its appearance in the EVMS yearbook. In the place and time where I grew up, many actions that we rightfully recognize as abhorrent today were commonplace. My belief that I did not wear that costume or attend that party stems in part from my clear memory of other mistakes I made in the same period of my life. That same year, I did participate in a dance contest in San Antonio, in which I darkened my face as part of a Michael Jackson costume. I look back now and regret that I did not understand the harmful legacy of an action like that. It is because my memory of that episode is so vivid that I truly do not believe I am in the picture in my yearbook. You remember these things. As I began my career and met my wife, Pam, I also began to develop a stronger understanding of this country's history and the harm that certain actions and attitudes cause. That does not excuse my behaviors up to that point, but it did offer me an opportunity to change and to grow, and I took it. I pursued my career as a soldier, a physician, and as a public servant because I wanted to help people. The experiences I had in each of those chapters and the people I met along the way helped me form a set of values that define the person I am now and the way I aspire to lead this Commonwealth as your governor. In some ways, my personal history mirrors that of this Commonwealth. There are actions and behaviors in my past that were hurtful. But like Virginia, I have also made significant progress in how I approach these issues. I am far from perfect, and I can always strive to do more. But I have devoted my entire life, my career in the Army, as a pediatrician, and in public service, to making life better for all people, no matter who they are. Today, I am not ready to ask Virginians to grant me their forgiveness for my past actions. I also do not fully expect that they will immediately believe my account of these events. Right now, I am simply asking for the opportunity to demonstrate beyond a shadow of a doubt that the person I was is not the man I am today. I am asking for the opportunity to earn your forgiveness. If I were to listen to the voices calling on me to resign my office today, I could spare myself from the difficult path that lies ahead. I could avoid an honest conversation about harmful actions from my past. I cannot in good conscience choose the path that would be easier for me in an effort to duck my responsibility to reconcile. I took an oath to uphold this office and serve the people of this Commonwealth to the best of my ability. As long as I believe I can effectively fulfill that task, I intend to continue doing the business of Virginia. I believe this moment can be the first small step to open a discussion about these difficult issues and how they contribute to the greater racism and discrimination that defines so much of our history. This very house stands as a monument to the dark and complicated history of this Commonwealth. These walls are adorned with portraits of men and women who owned slaves, actively oppressed people of color, as well as men and women who stood tall and advanced the causes of equality and racial justice in the Commonwealth and this country. In that discussion, it will not be my role to speak to Virginians about these issues. My responsibility is to listen, to learn, and to continue to grow as a man and as a leader. I am ready for an honest conversation about racial injustice and the need for real reconciliation, real justice, and real equality. I believe the agenda this administration is pursuing clearly demonstrates the progress both I and our Commonwealth have made since the darkest chapters of our history. I promise to fight for a Virginia that works better for all people, and our commitment to economic justice, access to health care, criminal justice reform, educational equity, and a clean environment reflect those priorities. As this conversation moves forward, I want to hear from Virginians from every walk of life about how we can fight even harder to build the Virginia that they deserve. Before I take questions, I want to take this opportunity to apologize to the many people who have been hurt by this episode and mistakes that I have made in the past. I am ready to earn your forgiveness, and I am ready to begin today. Thank you, and I look forward to your questions. Yes, sir.
Be crystal clear. You're saying that you had no idea this racist photo existed before it surfaced less than 24 hours ago.
The photo in the EVMS yearbook.
Yes.
That's correct. I was in the United States Army while I was in medical school. I knew where I was going upon graduation from medical school. I was doing rotations out of the state. I had nothing to do with the preparation of the yearbook, nor did I buy one. And so this was the first time, yesterday evening was the first time I saw this photo. It was shocking and it was horrific.
How do you account for one of your nicknames that's listed in the VMI yearbook in 1981, Coonman? What's your explanation for that?
My main nickname in high school and in college was Goose, because when my voice was changing, I would change an octave. There were two individuals, as best I can recollect, at VMI, they were a year ahead of me, that called me Coon Man. I don't know their motives or intent. I know who they are, but that was the extent of that, and it ended up in the yearbook, and I regret that.
Before you spoke, you had almost the entire Democratic establishment calling for your resignation. saying that it's just in Fairfax who deserves to stand where you're standing right now. What's your response to that?
You know, I think we have done a great job over the last year. We've worked on a lot of the challenges that I just outlined. This has hurt a lot of people. It's hurt a lot of people in our party. I suspect it's hurt people in the opposing party, and it's hurt Virginians. And I want to assure everybody, number one, that that is not my picture. That is not my person on that picture in the yearbook. We will continue to lead. We will continue to talk about the issues that are important. But we also will have a conversation as we move forward about trust. And I have been a man of honor. As you know, I was the president of the Honor Court at BMI. I ask my colleagues, I ask Virginians to accept my word, to realize that I have made mistakes in my past, to offer forgiveness, and then let's all as a Commonwealth move forward.
Right here. Senator, you talked there about some incident in San Antonio.
Yes.
That made you realize that you may have actually been in blackface at some time.
Yes.
Do you remember what year that was and more context around that event?
I remember exactly. It was in 1984. Which was my first year in San Antonio upon graduation from medical school.
And you were in the military at the time.
I was.
Had you ever posed in a KKK?
Absolutely not.
Two people in that photo.
Absolutely not. There is no way that I have ever been in a KKK uniform. I am not the person in that uniform, and I am not the person to the right.
And you talk about believing that you were getting an opportunity to be an effective leader.
Yes.
How much time do you think you have to prove that, or when will you know that you're not being effective?
It's a great question. And, you know, we're going to move forward from today. We'll take one day at a time. I obviously will have discussions with our caucuses, with the Republican caucuses, with the people of Virginia. And as long as I feel that I can lead, I will continue to do that. If I reach a point where I am not comfortable with that, then obviously we will sit down and have that discussion.
Governor,
yes.
That you can win over the support of your own party at this point. I mean, I've been speaking to Democrats who say they don't know if they can go forward with you. How do you bring them back up?
Yes, well, a lot of it is communication. And it starts today. I've obviously been talking to a lot of my colleagues. But it really starts today, to correct the record and to let them know that I am not the person stir yesterday. I have made mistakes in my past, as I admit it. But I am a person of my word. I will continue to work closely. I have great friends on both sides of the aisle. And as I said earlier, this has been hurtful. And that's why I reached out last night and called people and apologized. But I will continue to work as hard as I can to maintain their faith in me, to maintain my ability to lead. And we'll all hopefully work together and move forward.
Bonnie, Richard Press, Bonnie over here. Governor, at your inauguration, your minister, Reverend Jones, Brandon,
yes.
That you would always seek wise counsel.
Yes.
That was part of what you prayed, and that God would guide your thoughts and your steps.
Absolutely.
Can you tell us who you sought for wise counsel for this decision today?
Well,
and do you feel like a higher power guided you to this decision?
There is no question, and I'm a strong believer in God. I'm a member of First Baptist Church in Kateville, Virginia. My pastor, Reverend Jones, is actually here with us today. But obviously, one of the ways that I have been able to, I believe, govern successfully is to listen. I have a great cabinet. I have great relationships with people on both sides of the aisle. I am very secure in where I believe we need to take Virginia. And so as we have moved through this last 24 hours, I have spoken and consulted a lot of people. I have prayed about this, and I will continue to pray. And obviously, I couldn't stand here without the support of my wife, Pam.
Greg Schneider.
Governor, some Democrats have said that it's selfish of you to continue in office, to work out your own situation here at their expense during an election year when they have hopes of making gains in the legislature.
Yes.
Can you talk about that and what you would say to them?
Yeah, Greg, I think the first thing and why I felt so strongly about this statement and being here today is to set the record straight. And, you know, this started last night. We're now about 24 hours into this. It started with me being presented a picture from a yearbook that I had never seen before. That was horrific. And I reached out and apologized to my colleagues. I released two statements, as you know. And, you know, all I can do is what I've always done, and that's to be honest, to really to be able to listen, to be open with people. And as I think to the previous question, Greg, I plan to continue to lead. If we get to the point where we feel that we're not effective, that we're not efficient, not only for our caucuses, but the Commonwealth of Virginia, then we will revisit this and make decisions. Yes, Amy. The answer to your last question is no, he hasn't. Justin and I have a very, very close relationship. He is a wonderful person. He is doing a great job as Lieutenant Governor. I have spoken to him in person for a good period of time yesterday afternoon after this story broke, and I believe at least three times by phone I have kept him apprised of what is going on. He has been very supportive, and he will continue to be supportive. He is a wonderful person, and you know, the people of Virginia elect the Lieutenant Governor, put faith in the Lieutenant Governor in the event that they need to take over as governor. He'll be ready to do that.
Okay. Governor, you said that you recall an incident being addressed in Blackface. Why do you remember that incident so vividly and not this one? And what
have
the conversations been
with the prosecutor? Well, the reason that I so vividly don't remember this one because it didn't happen. Well, and that's where I think we need clarification. I take credit for recognizing that this was a horrific photo that was on my page with my name, Ralph Northam, above. I looked at it. My first impression, actually, that this couldn't be me. But there was so much hurt that I was feeling. People were calling. So I reached out and apologized to people for this very picture being on my page. And I have continued to discuss that as we have gone forward. And what has happened is that last night I finally had a chance to sit down and look at the photograph in detail. It is definitely not me. I can tell by looking at it. I have had friends also look at it and tell me it's not me. I have also had a classmate who I discussed this morning. We talked about this situation. And I said, you know, is there a possibility, you think, that someone could have put a photo on the wrong page? She said it happened on numerous pages in this very yearbook. So I still don't have a copy of the yearbook. We are in the process of obtaining that. We're going to look through. We're going to continue to gather evidence in the coming days. And I think all of you will be reassured to see that I am not in that photograph.
Governor, you said the San Antonio party darkened your face. I just want to be perfect.
Yes.
Were you in blackface?
I wasn't. I'll tell you exactly what I did, Alan. I dressed up in a, what's his name? Michael Jackson, excuse me. That's why I had Pam with me. I had the shoes, I had a glove, and I used just a little bit of shoe polish to put under my, or on my cheeks. And the reason I used a very little bit is because I don't know if anybody's ever tried that, but you cannot get shoe polish off. But it was a dance contest. I had always liked Michael Jackson. I actually won the contest because I had learned how to do the moonwalk. But then let me tell you what happened, Alan. I have a very close friend who was my assistant during the campaign. I don't think he would mind me telling you his name. His name is Seth Opoku-Yeboah. And during some of our long rides around the Commonwealth, the very issue of blackfacing came up. And he really did a good job communicating to me why that's so offensive. And it was actually during that conversation, I said, you know, Seth, I put some polish on my face. I competed in a dance contest dressed up as Michael Jackson. And I said, I assume you probably would think that's offensive. He said, I would. And I said, you know what, Seth? I appreciate you being open with me. I apologize for what I've done in the past, and I can promise you I'll never do that again in the future.
Yeah, I got reported with the pilot. We talked to some
other students at BDMS who said that, you know, they always submitted their photo for the yearbook. There are four pictures on the yearbook.
Yes.
Did you choose all four of them? Did you choose three of them? And then if you're saying the last one is not you, are you saying that it's placed there without your consent?
It's...
Are you saying the last photo is placed there without your consent?
Yes, there are three photos, too, if I could look at the picture, but I think there are three photos. One, me standing in front of a car that I restored, one kneeling, like on a farm setting, and then one just a more formal picture. I did submit those. Where this other picture came from, I don't know, and I'm not going to sit here and hypothesize or speculate how it happened, but I can only imagine that if there are a number of photos laid out on a table and someone is pasting those on page after page, that one could get mistakenly put on the wrong page. And as I said earlier, this has happened numerous times in this particular yearbook, and I suspect that's what happened in this case.
Governor, how do you expect people to believe you? Because yesterday we're accepting responsibility for this, and then within less than 24 hours they're saying, no, it wasn't me. Why should they believe?
I'm accepting responsibility that this photograph was on my page in the yearbook. I regret that. It is horrific. It made me sick when I saw it. But I will tell you that my word, I will stand and live by my word. I was the president of the VMI Honor Court. Our code there is lie, cheat, steal, or tolerate those do. That's the most meaningful thing to me in my life. I tell the truth. I'm telling the truth today. That was not my picture in the photo.
Brendan,
on the yearbook's response to that drinking, is it possible, were you a big drinker at the time, and is it possible that you were drinking, you took a photo, and just don't remember?
You know, I have had a drink over the years, several drinks over the years, but I have never been to the point where I'm not in touch with my surroundings. The whole point, and this is what really baffled me of this situation. I looked at that photograph. Once I started thinking, I said, if I had dressed up like that, had put whatever was on that person's face, and stood beside a costume of the KKK, I would remember that. And I have no recollection at all. And there's some other things, as I said, if one looks at the picture, it's not my picture. I remember the dance contest in San Antonio just like it was yesterday. And so my conclusion from that is I certainly take responsibility for what happened in San Antonio. I have learned from that. But this was not my picture. I was not in that costume either as black-faced or as KKK. And it's not me.
Time for a couple more.
Governor, if that would have been you in that picture, would you have resigned? And why do you think that picture is any more offensive than dressing up as Michael Jackson? Are both of those things disqualifying?
It's a great point. And, you know, I at the time, when I dressed up as Michael Jackson, it was a talent show. I didn't personally find it as unacceptable at that time. I have learned since, again, in talking to my friend Seth. The picture, though, that is in the EVMS yearbook with the black facing and the member of the KKK is just horrific. It's totally offensive. And so I find both of them to be wrong. I wasn't responsible for the first one. I can tell you that. I take responsibility for the issue in San Antonio. You know, I don't want to ever, you know, try to judge someone's intent, but it is perhaps coincidental. And, you know, I guess most accurately is to probably ask the person. I've heard kind of secondhand from that person why he did this, but I would rather it come from you. But there was an agenda involved.
Yes.
Governor, kind of to that point, you've run two pretty rough and tumble statewide races in recent years. Anyone who would think that goes through this kind of a race does a self
search of this kind of material, while inevitably your opponents are probably doing it as well.
Yes.
Did it ever dawn on you to go back and look for your books from everyone from kindergarten all the way through, just in case there was something?
Well, you know, we always are asked when we're running, you know, what kind of things should our people look into. Obviously, there's opposition research on the other side. But I will tell you, no, I didn't ever really think about that there would be anything offensive in my EVMS yearbook. But this literally hit me like a ton of bricks last night. It totally caught me off guard. So it was something that I wasn't expecting. And to your point, the people that do that kind of research, perhaps they should have looked at that.
And you said that the competition in San Antonio was a dance competition?
Yes.
And it was that you danced the moonwalk?
That's right.
Are you still able to moonwalk?
Inappropriate circumstances.
My wife says inappropriate circumstances.
Why do you feel like this is the best way forward for Virginia for you to stay in office? When your constituents, your top leaders saying they've lost trust in you.
Sure.
Reopened.
What I really want to do is talk about the racism and the hatred and the bigotry that I have fought so long and hard for. I mean, I'll give you just a quick example. You know, when the white supremacists marched into Charlottesville, I was there with then Governor McAuliffe and our Attorney General just denouncing that. And so I have felt very strongly about that. We still have a lot of issues to work on as we move forward, as I talk about inequities in access to voting, access to education, health care, the justice system. So we still have a lot of work to do. And I really think this is probably a good opportunity to, you know, to talk about that issue with what has happened this week.
Hey, Governor?
Yes.
The Virginia Legislative Black Caucus has been viewing the remarks and has already responded to amplifying their calls previous. How do you respond to that?
Well, I will continue to reach out and talk to them about this issue. Again, I want to reinforce, as I was saying earlier in the question, I have made mistakes in my life, but what caused this stir up yesterday, I'm not responsible for. That is not me in that photo. And I would hope that all the caucuses and the people of Virginia will realize that. That's not me. That's not who I am. And while I have made mistakes in my past, what started this yesterday is something that is not realistic, and I just hope people will realize that.
Governor, you said in your remarks,
hey, John.
You've been moved for racial reconciliation.
Yes.
And this state kind of used what happened as an opportunity to move forward. In that spirit, there's lots of people who are saying that they hope that this moment should prompt people on this day to take down the monuments to Confederate soldiers. Where did you come down on that at this point? If you do stay in office, would you put them to take down the statue?
As you know, Jonathan, we've had that discussion. That discussion really was highlighted after the Charlottesville episode. And I really think what Virginia has looked at is doing this on a regional basis to let the localities assess the statues that they have. And if they find them unacceptable, to remove them. I think the other thing that we can do as we move forward. Pardon me? Well, that's going to be a discussion for the city of Richmond.
Governor, it's hard to still understand how this all came to be. So you're saying that you were able to get together with a group of your friends and family and closely look at this photo to come to the determination that it wasn't you. And I think that's deeply troubling for a lot of people. How is this something that you could be confused about? Was this part of a lifestyle, or was this one particular incident, as you described, related to Michael Jackson?
Well, not to repeat what we have already said, but this was, when I was shown this last night, it was horrific, and it really horrified me. And so we did what we needed to do last night, I think, and that it was to reach out and make sure to apologize for those that may be hurt. But I will tell you that the more time I've had to think about this, to realize that I have no recollection at all of ever dressing up like that, to be able to talk to some of my classmates who said that they have never seen me in any outfit like that. And just finally, to be able to talk to my roommate. We're very close. I think some of you have already reached out to him. Rob Marsh, who was the medic in Black Hawk Down.
And there's a correlation between the photo and your nickname, right? And you're saying that your nickname was rooted in the fact that you're Bushing Hopkins? So there's a correlation there.
Well, two nicknames. The
nickname was what about the other nickname? How do you respect
that? I said, you need to put your hands to refer to me. I don't know what their intent was
last
with that.
Sarah, and then here. Governor, I wanted to ask you, you said that you think not resigning, you think resigning would be the easier path in this case. As you noted, multiple leaders, including a lot of Black leaders, in the NAACP, the Black Caucus here in Virginia, that's the path they've asked you to take.
Yes.
Why not, out of respect for their wishes,
you know, I will continue to have discussion with them. Again, I really think if they will listen to me, again, I'd hate to be so redundant, but for them to know that this was not me in that picture, that was not Ralph Northam. And I hope that they will accept that. I hope that they will take my word. And then we need to continue to have discussions. As I said earlier, I have talked to these individuals in the last 24 hours on numerous occasions, and I will continue to do that to hopefully build their trust and let them know that, you know, we've done a good job in the first year. We've made some great accomplishments in Virginia. I'm sorry, what was the first? I will certainly be open to their desires and concerns, but you know, one of the things I think we'll be able to do, we're collecting information on this particular photo, and I hope to have some more information in the next couple of days, and I will continue to present that to them and just let them know that that was not me.
On that point, Governor, for clarity, you seem to suggest in the course of your comments that there were other mistakes in this medical school's yearbook, that your page wasn't the only page. What informed that? Is that entirely anecdotal, or do you have something else to back?
No, and I would welcome you to look at that particular yearbook. There are numerous pictures in there of face painting, none of whom are me. Blackface. That are in there, and I believe, I don't know if they've released it yet, but I think Eastern Virginia Medical School is in the process of reviewing each of their yearbooks, and we'll put a statement out that it is unacceptable and that we need to make a change as we move forward.
Thanks,
Governor, you said in the last 24 hours you should have the time to recollect and think back on your experience, discuss it with your family and former roommates. Shouldn't those discussions have taken place before you came out released a written statement and then a video statement? And if that was a mistake, maybe a misjudgment, why should the people of Virginia trust your judgment going forward on other issues?
Well, I've always been straightforward with folks and honest, and that's what I'm doing now. And again, just to see this horrific picture yesterday evening that was on my page with my name over top of it, that was horrifying to me, and so I did feel it was necessary to reach out and discuss that, as I said, and I'm not going to be redundant, but in the last 24 hours, I have been able to review the picture, talk to people, and the picture is not me.
Why didn't that happen before, though?
Well, I just thought it was very important.
That's quite the thing to admit.
As you may imagine, there were a lot of people calling. You all do a good job releasing information, and I was doing everything that I could to really communicate with the people that I felt needed to be communicated with that were hurt by this.
So initially, you initially thinking it was you?
Pardon me?
Did you initially think that it could have been you?
I didn't study it as well as I should. Let me just say, finish my question. The first comment that I made to the individual that showed it to me, I said, this can't be me.
It sounds like a question more than a statement.
Well, it's not me. And it was horrific. And the fact that it was on my page was just unacceptable. And I felt the need, as did my staff, to reach out and apologize to these folks.
How were you during the Michael Jackson incident? What time frame is that?
During that, I was 25.
What steps are you taking to investigate the picture? Can you talk a little bit more about that?
There are several different measures to look at things such as facial recognition. And again, I hope everybody in Virginia will be patient with me. That's going to take a little bit of time. And that's really, Greg, why I don't want to rush into any decisions. I want to have all the facts, and I want Virginia to have all the facts. That's important to me. Well, I will continue to work with my staff and continue to reach out and My phone has been working very hard in the last 24 hours, and I'll continue to do that. It's all, you know, this process of leadership is all about communication, and I've done a good job in the past with that, and that's what I plan to do in the upcoming days.
If you knew it wasn't you, why not just say that publicly?
Alan, I didn't know at the time. There was so much happening, but like I was
trying. What did you know? You just said you saw the picture and said that can't be me. Why not just say that publicly?
Well, because my word is important to me, and my first intention, Alan, was to reach out and apologize. And there, as you might imagine and understand, there are a lot of people that are hurt by this, and I wanted to reach out to them. After I did that last night, I sat and looked at the picture. Today I've had the opportunity to talk to classmates, my roommate, and I am convinced that is not my picture.
Could there be other photos that look similar to this of you in blackface that could come out?
Absolutely not.
Thank you, guys.
Governor, you're asking folks now to take some time, let this investigation unfold, avoid a rush to judgment. Isn't that the opposite of what took place yesterday with yourself when you rushed to judgment and apologizing for this rather than waiting for the full facts to come out and then sharing those with the public?
It's a fair question, but I just really thought it was important to, again, when this broke yesterday afternoon, there were just a lot of people calling, and I just felt like I needed to talk to them and to put out a statement that this is unacceptable to have a picture such as that in the yearbook on my page, and so that's why I started reaching out to people.
You can do that without saying that is me in that picture, though.
It has taken time for me to make sure that it's not me, but I am convinced. I am convinced that I am not in that picture.
Some of the lawmakers who wanted to resign said the chance, the possibility that you thought it could be you is enough of wrong. What do you say to that?
You know, Alan, I don't know how many times I can say this, but again, it. You know, if you could go back sometime and reword things, maybe that would be a good idea. Hindsight's 20/20. But I saw this last night. It was horrifying to me. It literally shocked me, and I just felt it important to reach out and let people know that that I was sorry that this picture not only was in the yearbook but was on the page with my name on it.
Michael Jackson face paint and blackface photo. Is that a meaningful
distinction? That's up to them. You know, if everything is in sound bites these days, but I really do believe that both of them are wrong, but there's a contrast between the blackface and someone standing there in a Ku Klux Klan outfit and me dressed up in a Michael Jackson costume for a dance contest. And again, they're both wrong. But I would hope people would see the contrast.
If that picture had come out with you and Resign, there was a picture that had come out with you and your face darkened at the Michael Jackson contest. Would that then have been enough for you to say, I need to step aside?
No, because I'm letting you know right now, without a picture, that this is what happened. And that's the way I operate. I want to be honest with people. And again, as I said earlier, I discussed this with a person of color. He let me know why this was offensive. I apologized to him. And I will never do it again. There wasn't a photo, number one. Yes, I mean, I would have been glad to talk about it, but I didn't see the need. Nobody asked me about it, so.
Has this experience allowed you to better understand what these symbols potentially do to people of color and how they harm them, the emotional trauma associated with that?
There's no question. You know, we live and learn. We're all human. And this has been a tremendous learning experience. And, you know, I will tell you, I had the unique opportunity growing up on the Eastern Shore. I was in public school during desegregation. I have a lot of African-American friends that I went to school with, played ball with, and I suspect I've had as much exposure to people of color as anybody, but I have learned a lot, to answer to your question, and I will continue to learn.
Michael Jackson costume, even after all these photographs,
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear.
Why would you decide to do the Michael Jackson costume in that way, even though you say you had, experiences around black friends and black people growing up?
Why did I dress up? Yes, I didn't realize at the time that it was as offensive as I have since learned. And knowing that, what I know now, I wouldn't have done it. But at the time, I didn't realize that.
Thanks so much, guys.
How do you think this will affect your medical practice?
Hold on a second. Well, right now, I think it's important that we take one day at a time. I think that we will continue to collect information to definitively prove, in addition to my word, that I'm not in that picture.
Especially when people of color, knowing and hearing all of this now. And also, what about the Lee Jackson holiday in Virginia that you had direct control
over? Yes, as you know, there was a piece of legislation this year to make Election Day a holiday. It didn't pass, but certainly in that discussion, if Election Day were a holiday, would we need to rid ourselves of a different holiday? And that was part of the discussion, to eliminate Lee Jackson. It's actually a four-day weekend, as you know, on the Friday, with Monday being Martin Luther King Day. Regarding taking care of sick children, as I've said, I learn every day. I have taken care of literally thousands of children and their families. And I can tell you, I treat everyone the same way. Nobody has ever thought or accused me of being racist. And if and when I practice again, I will continue that same direction.
Do you think, as a grown adult, that it's problematic that you need to have it explained to you that blackface is offensive?
No, different ways. And for us to have a dialogue, for example, me with you, to you let me know what's offensive to you, and vice versa.
But you explained that you've had an extraordinary exposure to people of color, to people who may not have the same life experience.
And as I just said, I have made mistakes in my life, and I will continue to learn.
Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you all very much.
I'm Anna Cabrera in New York. You are live in the CNN newsroom, and this is breaking news here on CNN. He said, "It wasn't me." The Democratic governor of Virginia, Ralph Northam, they're under fire from every direction right now and under pressure to resign. And this is all after a racist photograph emerged from his medical school yearbook. That picture is one of several photos on this page dedicated to Northam.